morning. Hope everybody's having a good time. Rising Sun kids are halfway through their fall break. Switzerland County students are beginning their fall break. We got a lot of people traveling, so we're glad that you're here with us this morning. Wanted to start with a few announcements. After a long layoff because of COVID, we are going to have a business meeting this morning after church. We invite you to stay and be a part of that. We are going to help with Jacob Parker's funeral dinner. Randy and Larice C's son-in-law at one point, is the father of two of their grandkids. He passed away of COVID, and we are going to help with that funeral dinner. Thelma is going to be coordinating it. The thing is, we don't exactly know when it's going to be yet. Jacob's mother has been COVID positive, so they have not been able to go to the funeral home. I believe they are going tomorrow, the 11th. I'll be doing the funeral, and I heard from Haskell Morrison that they believe in their schedule, if it all works, the visitation will be Thursday night, and the funeral will be Friday at 11 at the church, or at the funeral home. So the dinner would be Friday afternoon. So if you can help with that, if you can provide a side dish, please get a hold of Thelma, or you can get a hold of Renzi. He's sitting back there. And so it gives us an opportunity to help with those folks. So we believe that will be Friday. Watch your text messages when we know exactly when that's going to be. There's a silent auction going on in the back today. Last Sunday, our merge and youth groups participated in a little project. We talked about the Old Testament verse where Elisha and the woman with the oil, where he told her to gather all the jars and fill them with oil. We split them into four groups, and I gave each group a paperclip, and I gave them 2 hours to go out and see what they could barter and turn their paperclip into. And 2 hours later, they came back with all that stuff. So we decided that we would have a silent auction to determine which of the four groups won, and then all the money from the silent auction will go to our youth group activities. So look around back there, and the coat and the dress shirt hanging on the coat tree are part of the auction. The coat tree is not part of the auction. It's there for. So you can look at those things. That'll be going on today and next Sunday, and so we invite you to check that out. We're going to have a baptism here next Sunday, guys, we need to get the baptistry set up, so we invite you to be in prayer for that. And then on the 23rd, we're going to have our fall festival, and Amanda Wallace and Amanda Crawl are in charge of that, and we are going to need people. We need people to help with games, including face painting. We need hot dog buns, chips, and desserts, handheld desserts like cookies, brownies, single item kind of desserts, and also bottled water. We're looking, Amanda, books and coloring books. We're having a book walk instead of a cake walk, right? Is that what I'm reading? So we're going to have a book walk instead of a cake walk. So if you have coloring books or children's books, you can donate for that. And then just general prizes. And then we're also going to have a trunk or treat as a part of that. So I think there are a bunch of sign-up sheets back in the back, and Amanda will be back there after the service. So sign up to help with those things. That's going to be an exciting thing. We're also going to have our live nativity again in December. Mike Edwards is heading that up. You'll be looking for more information on that. And also our sound panels, we need to get those up on the walls. So we're developing a plan here pretty quick to as to how those are going to be. Again, our Sunday school programs, Pam and Richard are leading our Sunday school sessions. We have two different ones. I think this was week three. And then we'll move on. I don't know, was the plan to switch them? Are they going to teach them again? Where's Courtney? We're going to talk about that next. Okay, might be the plan. Make a priority to try to get to Sunday school. Also, our Bible studies. Tom leads our Tuesday night Bible study here at 6:30, and then Melissa leads our women's Bible study here on Wednesdays at 6:30. So we invite you to be a part of those things. She's not here, but one of several of our church kids had a pretty special day yesterday, and one of our older church kids led the way. But one of them did something that is rather historic. We don't want to get by. Yesterday morning at the cross country sectional, which Meg coaches, our girls finished second and our boys finished fifth. And they're going to advance to their Switzerland County's kids. They're going to advance to the, both teams are going to advance to the regional this week. Ashlyn is a part of that team, girls team. But Claire Rogers was the individual sectional champion yesterday. It's the second time in school history that we have had. It's the third time overall. Jenny and Kevin's son, Devin, won the boys sectional, and I believe that's the only time we've ever had a boy win it. Clay Meyer ran a regional, but he didn't win a sectional. And Switzerland County's girls, Leah Anders, won a sectional. And so Claire yesterday was the second girl in Switzerland County history to win that. And then she topped that off by going to Rising Sun last night and was a part of the girls sectional team, Switzerland County girls sectional team that won the sectional last night. So I believe Claire would be the, Greg pointed this out, Claire is an individual sectional champion. She won two sectionals in two different sports on the same day. And I'm pretty sure that's never been done before because your schedules don't line up like that. And we had a conversation, would that ever happen again? And I said, the only person I can think it ever happened to again is her next year. So, and the year after that, and the year after that. So we're really proud of Claire and Ashlyn and all the kids. I know Kale and Luke ran on the middle school team, and Meg's looking forward to getting her hands on them next year for the high school team. Dylan runs on the high school team, and so we're excited about all that. Next week when Claire's here, they took a little trip for a break. Want to make sure you congratulate her. Turning to our prayer list, Darren Stokel, who lives down the road, he is in Good Sam with COVID pneumonia, been kind of following his progress with Jen, his wife. Jen is also positive with COVID, but she is home. She's not as bad as Darren, but Darren is getting better. LaVeda Bladen, Rachel and Shona's mom, she is having breast cancer surgery tomorrow, and then she's going to begin radiation treatments. The Jacob Parker family, who we talked about earlier, and also Jacob's brother Jimmy. Jimmy Parker is in the hospital. He's in the hospital with COVID, and I believe he's getting better, right? He's home? Okay, so he's home. Amen to that. Audrey Casey, a friend of Bill Madison's, former resident of Allensville. She and her daughter, Angie Henderson, they now live in Campbellsburg, Kentucky, and they both have been dealing with serious cases of COVID. Tim Doey White, Sandy Ward's cousin, he's been dealing with COVID. Donnie Ballard, who is Allie Hallett, Chloe Ballard's dad, I just got a message from Amy, as a matter of fact. Let me see if I can track it down real quick. There he is. He is holding on, been fighting a fever for a couple of days, has two air pockets and a foot drop bed sore. He's on 50 on the ventilator, and oxygen is at 96, hoping he can start healing so they can begin to wake him up. They're also doing some blood work to check on a possible infection. So we want to remember Donnie. Also, Amy's Aunt Gloria, who has been dealing with cancer, has gone into hospice. So we want to remember them. Raymond Furnish continues to deal with COVID. Glenn Potts is recovering from COVID. I know his family was able to spend some time with him yesterday. So we give glory to God for that. Renzi's mom, Elva's in the nursing home. How's she doing, Renz? Okay. So Bonnie Simon, Angie Haskell's mom, is having radiation treatments. Logan Day, our little buddy, he is continuing to recover and improve. And Jill, as always, we want to remember Jill Cooley. She's continuing to go through her treatments for pancreatic cancer. And so we want to remember her and Roger, and also just all the unspoken requests that we have. So join me in a word of prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to come here and to gather here in your name. And Father, as we lift up these names, some that have been spoken outwardly and we know information about, others are names that we haven't had updates on recently. And others, Father, are in our hearts and minds, and we haven't chosen to share those. Father, just help us rest as members of your family. Just rest in the assurance that even though we know the current situation, you know the current situation, and you also know the outcome. Father, we just ask in all of these cases that the outcome would bring glory to you. Be with us now, Father, as we go through the remainder of our service. And we ask these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Everybody please stand. We're going to start out this morning with a couple congregational songs. We're going to start with Nothing But the Blood.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole? Blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
That were next.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all spirit sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. The splendor of the King, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, the Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. You're the name above all names, Lord, you're worthy of all praise, and my how great is our God.
One more time.
You're the name above all names, Lord, you're worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Adam, would you please pray for us?
In all of that cross-country stuff, I completely missed Ellie. Ellie Keith was the individual girls' champion in the middle school conference cross-country meet. So Meg has a lot to look forward to. In fact, the girls' team is probably going to get so good, Meg, that David will want to coach them. You never know. You didn't know we had a lacrosse team, did you? All right. Parents, have you ever left your child with a sitter or at a friend's house? And when you get back, you hear something like, well, he was absolutely perfect. Never had one problem. What a great child you have, right? And you're happy to hear that, but you also remember that 15 minutes before you got there, they were throwing bananas across the living room. You know, you wonder, did somebody kidnap my kid and replace them with this one? Because apparently he doesn't act in other people's houses like they do in mine, right? The child that you're describing certainly doesn't sound like the child that's been living in my house lately. Well, our scripture this morning is found in the Epistle of James. Epistle's a fancy word for letter. And you may commonly call it the book of James. It's one of those sections of the Bible that's tucked away towards the back. It's right between Hebrews and 1 Peter, and sometimes it's a little hard to find. But just because it's towards the back doesn't mean that it's not important, and we're gonna talk about it today. Although the James who wrote the letter and the letter is named after isn't specifically identified, it is nearly unanimous in the opinion that this was written by James, the half brother of Jesus. So this letter is referred to by some Bible scholars as Old Testament Proverbs dressed up in New Testament clothes. And I found that funny, but I also found it very true. When you read the book of James, you can't help but think, this sounds like a lot like the book of Proverbs, you know, wise sayings. And basically, James uses his letter to tell his readers one common thing. God's people ought to act like God's people. God's people ought to act like God's people. What a unique concept, right? God's people ought to act like God's people. So we're going to look at a couple of verses that are found in James chapter 1. So if you've been flipping over there, it's the very first chapter. We're going to look at verses 19 through 20, and if you don't have your Bibles with you today, it's going to be up on the screens. But James writes this in James chapter 1, beginning in verse 19. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word and does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in the mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. So ends the reading of God's word. Join me in prayer again this morning. Heavenly Father, again, we just thank you for this day. I thank you for those who are here. I ask that your blessing of protection be upon those members of our church family who are away from us today. Keep them safe until you can bring them back to us. Father, as we look at your word today, I just ask that you would open not only our minds, but our hearts, that through this, Father, we would draw closer to you. Father, we love you. We're honored by your presence here, and we ask these things in your son's name. Amen. Now, a couple more things about James. When Jesus was alive, remember James was his half-brother, James did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah. He kind of just thought he was his crazy older brother. And if you have a brother, if your brother told you that he was God, would you believe him? I have two, and I'm not taking that bait on either one of them, right? But after Jesus was resurrected, James did become a believer. He saw him. And James became an apostle, and you may see the word apostle around, and you hear disciple and apostle, and an apostle, like I said, it's a word you may hear. It is someone who saw Jesus and became to believe in Jesus after his resurrection. So he was not a disciple where he was with Jesus during Jesus' time before his crucifixion, where he learned from him. He was around him, but he didn't believe him. He only came to believe him after the resurrection, so that's what separates being a disciple from being an apostle. Paul would also be considered an apostle because of his encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus and then his following the missions that he went on. So anyway, James, an apostle, he became the leader of the church in Jerusalem, the leader of the early Christian church. In Jerusalem, he became the leader of what they would call the way at that point. And obviously, Jerusalem is the very epicenter of Judaism, right? So that fact alone must have been incredibly tough and dangerous for him to lead the new church in this place that basically is rooted in the old way of doing things. You know, all he had to do was look at how they treated his brother, and he would think that probably this may not go well. So he's running this church. He's leading this growing church in the middle of Jerusalem, and it must have taken an incredible amount of faith to take on that task. Someone who had to have absolutely been convinced of the truth of his message. He went from... that's my older brother. We all think he's a little nuts. He was my half brother, and he was God's son. He's the Messiah. So here is this man in the middle of this city, converting people away from what has been historically the taproot of this city. And he's making these conversions and he's leading this growing church. And in the midst of it, he writes this letter. He writes it to Jewish Christians, not only in Jerusalem, but all around the area. People who were born and raised in the Jewish faith, who had walked away from their Jewish faith and had become followers of the way, who had become Christians. And as we've talked about many times in here, when you walked away from your Jewish heritage and you walked into a relationship with Jesus, there are many consequences to what you were about to face. You lost your family, you lost your job, and you lost probably your status in the community. So doing that wasn't something that was done lightly. You know, when I was preparing this message, I thought about the Whitmers, who are our friends who are missionaries in Thailand. And they told a story. They were having a baptism on a Sunday afternoon, and a young lady who was going to be baptized, when she showed up, she had suitcases with her, and everything she owned she had packed and brought. And they said, "Well, why did you bring all that stuff?" And she said, "Well, after I'm baptized, I won't be able to go back home again. So I'm going to have to go find someplace else to live. I'm going to have to go find someplace else, something else to do, because my parents and my family aren't going to allow me to come home." Now think about that. Think about making a decision that at the time you publicly make it will completely change every relationship you have. I think if some of us were honest with ourselves, we'd decide maybe we aren't going to do that, at least not publicly, for fear of the repercussions. But in Jerusalem and around that area at this time, that's exactly what was happening. These people who had known nothing but Judaism their whole life are suddenly going, "You know what? I need to place my faith here now." So the people who James is writing to at this time, they had been through a lot of trials and through a lot of tribulation in becoming what we would refer to today as Christians. Now, that term hadn't been used yet, like I said, but they were followers, they were believers. But that's really not what James is addressing here. What he's addressing here is how they are acting, not in public, but in most cases towards each other. So he's looking at them and he's saying, "You know, I understand where you came from to get to where you are. We all understand that. But now that you're here, I need to talk to you about how you're treating each other." Right? And in verse 19, he addresses them, these Jewish Christian people. But how can we walk away today and not understand how important this is to us too? He says, "Be quick to listen, be slow to speak, and be slow to become angry." Be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Now, especially in our world today, how many people follow those three basic thoughts? Wander onto any social media platform that you want and look at what people are writing and how people are responding. And I guarantee you that very, very few of them are listening and not speaking and are not becoming angry. I mean, it seems pretty easy, right? Listen to what people are saying. Don't speak immediately. Speak when it's your time. And no matter what's going on, don't get angry about it. See, we live in a social media world where people can't wait to get angry about it. They get halfway through somebody's post on Facebook and they're immediately, "Here it comes, the other side," whatever that side is. "And I'm going to talk you down, and in some cases, I'm going to yell you down because I don't agree with you." But remember, James here isn't addressing everybody. He's addressing Jesus followers. He's addressing Christians. It's people who have already gone through all of those problems and all of those issues that go on in society by declaring their love for Jesus. But for some reason, they're acting exactly like everyone else. And as we started this with, throughout James's whole letter, he focuses on that God's people ought to act like God's people. And he's looking at God's people who are acting like everybody else. He says there's an issue. Because God's people ought to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, and you aren't that. Then and now, if you identify yourself as a Christian person, people ought to see something different in you, and they ought to see something different about you. Because our actions and our words matter. They matter to those people in the world who may be thinking about starting a relationship with Jesus. They matter to our families and to our children. And sometimes, even though we forget this part, how we act and what we say matters to God Himself. Because the world is slow to listen, quick to speak, and very quick to become angry. So when members of God's family do the opposite thing, people take notice. Right? We live in a world that is slow to speak, or slow to listen, quick to speak, and very quick to become angry. And when we act like everybody else, we make no difference for God's kingdom. But when we act in a completely different manner, people look and go, well, that was different. If you have a Facebook page, and most of you do, you may have encountered some time where somebody might try to goad you a little bit into an argument. They want to throw things at you to see how you will react. And I've had people before call me and go, did you see that? What that person posted on my Facebook page? What do you think I should do? And my answer is always the same thing. Nothing. Because when you engage them, they want you to engage them because then they can attack. And when you don't, when you choose not to engage them, when you choose not to do anything, then they don't know what to do. Because they want to be quick to speak and quick to become angry, and they don't want to listen. And they want you to be the exact same way. But when we do the opposite thing, people begin to take notice. See, our country today is deeply divided on all sorts of issues. But as Christian people, as members of God's family, as members of God's nation of believers, our focus is an eternal one, not a societal one. Does that mean we shouldn't concern ourselves with societal issues? No. But it doesn't mean that we should act like everyone else when it comes to dealing with them. There are places where Christians need to plant their flag. But sometimes we as Christians, we end up planting a really big bunch of flags. And we're planting them in places where I don't believe they need to be. And when we plant so many flags over so many different things, people look around and go, those people don't stand for anything. They apparently have an opinion on everything. And when we do choose to plant our flag, we should do so in a mindset where we are quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Here's what I believe. Well, I don't believe that way. Well, tell me why you don't believe that way. And when you get done, I'd like the opportunity to tell you why I believe how I believe. We're not going to get mad. I'm going to listen to you, and then I would appreciate that you would listen to me. Right? When we plant our flag as members of God's family, We need to keep those three things in mind when we do it. Because there are people who won't agree with you. There are people who won't agree with us. And that's all right. But when we listen to their point of view without jumping in and defending ourselves, parents of teenagers, do you ever get those conversations? I want to talk to you about this. And they immediately begin defending themselves before you can ever get to the point of where you were going to tell them, that's okay, I forgive you. And they're like, well, but wait a minute, you're, you know, if you just let me finish, it's okay at the end, right? And it's not just teenagers, but there are people that you work with that do that. They want to jump in and defend what they did before they ever hear what you say. They want to build a wall because they don't want to admit that they may be wrong. But when we listen to their point of view without jumping in and without defending ourselves, when we stay calm in an atmosphere where others are too quick to get mad, then the other person is more likely to listen and is more likely to hear our side of the issue, our side of the story. I mean, does it mean that we take our Bible or our big religious stick and just beat people down until they believe like we believe? No. But you never know where you're going to plant a seed. And if that person walks away from you going, man, they got their point of view and nothing else, then that's going to go away. But if they leave, even at that moment, if they leave and they say, I still don't agree with him, but I guess I see her point. And they begin to think about that. You never know how you may influence those people. And in the end, that difference may make an eternal difference in their lives. And that's far more important in whether or not we win an argument. But those three statements, they also come with some commands to us as Christians, to us as members of God's family. Verse 21, James writes, therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Get rid of all the moral filth that is so prevalent. Here's a sentence for you, right? Big statement. We could make a list of all the moral filth that is in our society today. We could list all of it, but you guys have lunch to get to and probably jobs to get to tomorrow, so we're going to have to cut that short. But it's important here to see that James isn't talking about getting rid of it in the world, right? James is talking about getting rid of it in us. See the difference? When he says, therefore, get rid of all the moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you, he's talking about the moral filth in you. He's talking about the moral filth in me. He's talking about the moral filth in us. He's not addressing a societal one. He's addressing a personal one. Because when God's people act like God's people, we rid ourselves of all of that moral filth that seeps into everyone else in society. And again, if God's people see the issues of the world and they embrace the issues of the world just like everybody else, then what in our lives could possibly impact someone who may be thinking about having a spiritual relationship that you claim to already have? You may have never heard this sentence before. You know, he claims to be a Christian. but he acts exactly like I act. So I must be okay. She claims to be a Christian, but she does all the stuff I do. So maybe I'm not so bad after all. You've heard me tell this story before, but it's so true. Rick Warren, author of Purpose Driven Life, he talks about being in a restaurant, a seafood restaurant one night, and he ordered sea bass. And they brought it to the table, and he took the salt shaker and he sprinkled salt on it before he started to eat it. And it hit him that he was about to eat something that had been submerged in a salt solution, in a saline solution, its entire life. It was born, raised, and lived in the ocean in salt water. It had been there its whole life until it got caught. But yet he was putting salt on it in order to be able to eat it. And it struck Rick Warren that even though this fish had lived its entire life in a salt solution, it had never allowed the salt solution to permeate it. It lived in it, but it never absorbed into it. See that? I think that's exactly how we're called to live. We live in it, just don't let it soak in. If you have let something soak in, James says, you got to get rid of all that moral filth that permeates our society. You got to get rid of it. And instead, look at the word that has been planted in you, it says, which can save you, it says. See, as God's people, we may be surrounded by the evils of the world. We may be surrounded by the moral filth, but that doesn't mean we have to participate in it. And then James writes a sentence that is so simple, but thousands of years later, it ought to tear at our hearts. Verse 22, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Don't just hear it, do it. What a unique concept that is, right? Now, I'm just making an observation here, but we all know people who go to church on Sunday, or maybe even more than that, but when they're outside of the building, they seem to forget everything they've heard. We all know people who are quick to tell us about their Bible quiet time, but then seem to forget everything else once they put the book down. And honestly, those people are not only deceiving people in society, but more critically, they're deceiving themselves. That's what James says. You're deceiving yourself. I'm okay. I read my Bible every morning. I'm good. I put a lot of money in that collection plate. I'm at church every time the doors are open. So that's got me covered. See, we begin to justify how we are based on what we do, not how we feel. But James tells his readers, and he tells us, that when you listen to the word, when you listen to what God is telling you, but you don't do what God is telling you, it's like you look in a mirror, and after a minute you walk away and you forget what you look like. Isn't that weird? I mean, who am I? You see yourself. Maybe you don't recognize yourself. I've spent time and I've talked with people who've been caught in addiction. And some of them have talked about being in places and they walk in one day and what really changed their outlook and made them decide that they needed to do something about their lives was that they will say, I saw my reflection that I didn't recognize the person I was looking at. Who's that? That's not me. And sadly, so many people, good, godly Christian people, today look around at the situation they find themselves in and they think, this isn't who I am. How did I get myself into this mess? And folks, this morning, my challenge to you is the exact same challenge that James laid out here. In all of your dealings, when you leave this place today, be quick to listen to other people, especially when they have a different opinion than you do. And as they are speaking, don't interrupt, give them their time, because it will make them more likely to listen to you when it's your time. And don't allow anger to take over the conversation, because that just melts down into two people yelling at each other. So even when you get mad, stay calm. Boy, I need to like write that on my forehead for myself. And finally, don't just listen to what God is asking you to do. Actually, as crazy as this may sound, do what it says. Do what He says. Because when we do all of those things, God's people will stand out from the world. God's people will be different. God's people will be people who others will want to come to and ask why you act the way you do and why aren't you reacting like everyone else. And in their hearts and in their minds and maybe in their mouth, they will say, how can I have what you have? How can they have what you have? And it opens up a whole new conversation. What a tremendous lesson for all of us. No matter where we are on our journey of faith, quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to get angry. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, we just thank you for this day. I thank you for the opportunity to share your word. And I ask, Father, that as we leave this place, we would think about your word. We would think about those things, that those situations in our lives where we have an opportunity to be quick to hear what other people say and slow to react to what other people say and slow to become angry as to what other people say. Father, help us see that all things we do point people towards you, not us. And Father, as we see these things, as we see these verses in James chapter 1 of our Bible, help us to not only read them and hear them, but do it. Father, maybe there's somebody here today who has issues with those things, who never really thought about those things, who never saw themselves in those capacities. Maybe there's somebody here this morning who's been thinking about being a part of your family, but felt like the anger that they had kept them away. Father, as we sing our hymn of invitation this morning, there are people around this room. I ask that if somebody needs to pray about something, if somebody needs to get something off their chest, I'll be here, or people will be around this room who want to pray with them and pray for them. Help us, Father, in all things we do grow closer to you. And we ask these things in your Son's name and for his sake. Amen.
Everybody will please stand. Our hymn of invitation is "Just As I Am."
Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am and waiting now to rid my soul of one dark block, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come.
All right. Thanks again for being here today. For those of you who are going to stay, we'll have our business meeting in there. We haven't had one in a year and a half, thanks to COVID and all that, but we're going to try to get back on track with those. In just a minute, we're going to sing our doxology. I'm going to ask David if he would close us in a word of prayer. And there, as we always say, there are people in this room, you don't know their names. Don't let them leave here until you do. And as always, post-COVID, give some hugs and some handshakes and let people know that you're glad that they're here. David?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and